send thy angel from heaven to guard, cherish, protect, listen, and defend all who are assembled in this thy holy temple. Through Jesus Christ, our Savior.
Ascribe unto the Lord worship and strength. Ascribe unto the Lord worship.
grant to us, O Lord, we beseech thee, the spirit to think and to do always such things as are right, that we who cannot exist without thee may by thee be enabled to live according to thy will. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever.
Amen.
A reading from the letter of Paul to the Ephesians. Therefore, putting away falsehood, let everyone speak the truth with his neighbor, for we are members one of another. Be angry, but do not sin. Do not let the sun go down in your anger, and give no opportunity to the devil. Let the thief no longer steal, but rather let him labor, doing honest work with his hands, so that he may be able to give to those in need. Let no evil talk come out of your mouths, but only such as it is good for edifying, as fits the occasion, that may impart grace to those who hear. And do not grieve the Holy Spirit of God, in whom you were sealed for the day of redemption. Let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you with all malice, and be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another, as God in Christ forgave you. Therefore, be imitators of God as beloved children, and walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
The Lord looketh down from heaven and beholdeth all the children of men. From the habitation of his dwelling, he considereth all them that dwell on earth. Behold, the eye of the Lord is upon them that fear him, to deliver their soul from death, and to feed them in the time of death.
Jesus said, all that the Father gives me will come to me, and him who comes to me I will not cast out. For I have come down from heaven, not to do my own will, but the will of him who sent me. And this is the will of him who sent me, that I should lose nothing of all that he has given me, but raise it up at the last day. For this is the will of my Father, that everyone who sees the Son and believes in him should have eternal life, and I will raise him up at the last day. The Jews then murmured at him, because he said, I am the bread which comes down from heaven. They said, is not this Jesus, the son of Joseph, whose father and mother we know? How does he now say, I have come down from heaven? Jesus answered them, do not murmur among yourselves. No one can come to me unless the Father who sent me draws him, and I will raise him up at the last day. It is written in the prophets, and they shall be all taught by God. Everyone who has heard and learned from the Father comes to me. Not that anyone who sees the Father except him who is from God. He has seen the Father. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes has eternal life. I am the bread of life. Your fathers ate the manna in the wilderness, and they died. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat it and not die. I am the living bread which comes down from heaven. If anyone eats from this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
Of this bread, he will live forever. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Ghost.
Amen.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I don't know if you noticed this, but it really struck me when I was looking at our readings for today. And at first glance, it would seem that they're completely different. You know, in Ephesians, Paul is talking about, you know, how we're to relate to one another as Christians. And then in our gospel lesson today, Jesus is talking about himself and about himself being the bread of life. And I was wondering, what does the first one have to do with the second? Well, my friend said it has everything to do with it, because you see, unless we are taking in Jesus as the bread of life, we're not going to be able to be the kind of people that Paul is writing about in Ephesians. It's not going to happen. Now, you've probably noticed this, as I have, when you go into different churches. Have you ever noticed how the architecture is different? It's not the same. Like if you go into some churches, they've got a huge pulpit right in the middle there, right? And maybe they've got a choir behind them. Or in some places, they've got just a sort of a plexiglass, lectern. And, of course, here at St. Timothy's, what do we have? We have the altar. We have the crucifix. And then over here, we have the pulpit. And my friends, that tells you a lot about what we believe, how we get to become the people of God that Paul is writing about in Ephesians, how we get there. You see, in many churches, they believe that, to become a community of God, to become the people of God, to become the kind of people that Paul writes about in Ephesians, the people who put away falsehood and speak the truth to one another, that comes by just the preaching of the word. And we don't reject that. We believe that, of course. That's what I'm doing right now. But we believe there's more to it. In fact, there's something that comes first and is more important, is more central, and that is what happens at the altar, is what Jesus has done. And Jesus is talking about this today. And he says, I'm the bread which came down from heaven. I am the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. So again, we see Jesus talking about himself as bread. And again, he's hearkening back, and I mentioned this last week, he's hearkening back to the Exodus, right? And this, of course, the Exodus in Jesus' time was the formative event of the Jewish people. It's where they got their identity. And we see in the Exodus, all the things that God did was about one central thing, to create a people for himself where he would be their God and they would be their people and they would worship God and that they would love one another. And so now what Jesus is talking about here in John's gospel, what he's saying is that I'm here to institute a new Exodus, a new covenant. Because remember, what happened at in the Exodus, it was the founding of the old covenant, right? It was at the Exodus where Moses received the Ten Commandments and where the sacrificial system was established. Remember? So fast forward, some time and they get to the promised land. And so what do you see in Israel in the Old Testament? You see a temple, right? And a temple is the place where God was worshipped. It's the place where his presence abided, right? And that was the place where animal sacrifices were offered. For what? For the propitiation of sins. And then, around all of the communities that made up Israel, what did you have in every town? You had a synagogue, right? So in the synagogue, what did you have? You had the reading of the word and the proclamation of the word, right? So two different places, temple, synagogue, right? And of course, what happened at the temple was the center of the life of the Jewish people. That's where they gathered to remember what God had done for them and who they were as a people, and their sins were then propitiated by the offering of animal sacrifices. And so that's where their identity was established, as the people of God. But there was a problem, and we all know this. We know that the bloodshed of animals, animal sacrifices, couldn't complete the work that God wanted to do. Because it really was only meant to be a foreshadowing of something greater, right? Temple, synagogue, is to be a foreshadowing of what was going to come later in Jesus Christ, right? So Jesus Christ comes and he begins to do all these things. You know, multiplication of loaves and fishes, healing of the sick, giving the blind their sight, raising the dead, and he's saying to them, I'm instituting a new covenant in myself. And he says, your fathers ate manna in the wilderness and they died. This is the bread which comes down from heaven, that a man may eat of it and not die. So what Jesus is saying is that, and he institutes it at the Last Supper, is the bread and the wine becomes his body and blood. And of course, what does that point to? That points to the crucifixion, right? With his blood shed on the cross. So then what Jesus is doing is saying, I've come to establish through the shedding of my blood, through the breaking of my body on the cross, a new covenant. A new covenant where there's no longer a need for any more animal sacrifices, because it's all been taken care of by me on the cross, my blood shed. But more deeper than that, Jesus says it's through my body and blood that I will create a new human race, what we call the church, right? A people for myself, right? It wouldn't just be Jews, but it'd be Gentiles as well. People of the whole world could now participate in this and become the people of God. And my friends, that's who we are, the people of God. So then, when you come to St. Timothy's and you see the altar, the crucifix, the pulpit on the side, what we're saying is we become a people. We are the people of God through what? First and foremost, through our participation in the death and resurrection of Jesus Christ, which is what we celebrate every time we have the Eucharist. And then we come forward as a people to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. And so thus, our identity, our spiritual nourishment is both nurtured and established. This is how we become the people of God. And so, through the preaching of the word, then, is added to it, but it's not central, right? It's important, but it's not central. That is central. So architecture, I'm not an architect, by the way, but architecture tells you something about what we believe. So, my friends, that's why it's so important that you receive the Eucharist, the body and blood of Jesus Christ. That's why we take it so seriously. That's why we approach it with such reverence and awe. Because what we're doing is that we're partaking in Jesus. Right? He says, I'm the living bread which came down from heaven. If anyone eats of this bread, he will live forever. And the bread which I shall give for the life of the world is my flesh. So, my friends,
every time we come forward to receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ, our life in Christ is strengthened, is renewed, is refreshed, is furthered, is established, each and every time. It's why our life as a people, as the people of God, as Christians, not just here at St. Timothy's, but Christians all over the world, our identity centers around the altar. The altar where the body and blood of Christ is. That's where we go to such lengths. You know, we take communion to shut-ins, to the sick. You know, and during the pandemic, we said, look, come, and if you want to just come into the parking lot, we'll bring it out to you, because it's that important to not receive the body and blood of Christ is to be spiritually malnourished, is to begin to spiritually starve yourself. Yes, is proclaiming the word important? You bet it is. Is hearing the word of God preached? Absolutely, which is why we do it. But your very life, your very sustenance comes from the altar, from Jesus Christ, his body and blood shed. After all, isn't that what his crucifixion is all about? His body broken, his blood shed. And so every time we come to the altar, we participate in that. It's about him making us into a new people. And so then, my friends, as we receive the living bread which comes down from heaven, something amazing and wonderful begins to take place. We become the people of God. We become the people that he always meant for us to be. We become the people that Paul's writing about in Ephesians. To become the people who put away falsehood, who speak the truth with one another. He says, we are members of one another. You know how we're members of one another? Because we all gather at the altar and we receive the body and blood of Jesus Christ. That's how we become members of one another. We're one people. And we have our one God and Savior, Jesus Christ. Doesn't matter who we are, where we came from. Around the altar, we become one people. And so Paul says, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and slander be put away from you with all malice. And be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving one another as God in Christ forgave you. You see, when we come forward, we're reminded of who we are and that we're forgiven and that we have been set free and that we are being transformed and that we are being made new, that we are being made, you know, that word Christian means little Christ, right? We're being made into little Christs to the praise of his glory. And so therefore, Paul says, be imitators of God as beloved children and walk in love. As Christ loved us and gave himself up for us, a fragrant offering and sacrifice to God. In the name of the Father, of the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus Christ, the only God's good Son.
oppression and degradation. Let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
That we may end our lives in faith and hope, without suffering and without reproach. Let us pray to the Lord.
Sacrament to your comfort, and make your humble confession to Almighty God. Without the need. Almighty God,
Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, maker of all things, judge of all men, we acknowledge to the way of our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed against thy divine majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do earnestly repent, and are heartily sorry for these our misdemeanors. The remembrance of them is grievous unto us, the burden of them is intolerable. Have mercy upon us, most merciful Father, for thy Son, our Lord Jesus Christ's sake. Forgive us all of the past, and grant that we may ever and ever serve and please thee in the news of life, to the honor and glory of thy name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, of his great mercy has promised forgiveness of sins to all those with hearty repentance and true faith turn into him. Have mercy upon you, pardon, and deliver you from all your sins. Confirm and strengthen you in all goodness and bring you to everlasting life through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Hear with comfortable words our Savior Christ says to all who truly turn to him. Come unto me, all ye that travail and are heavy laden, and I will refresh you. So God loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, to the end that all that believe in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. Here also what St. Paul said, this is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Here also what St. John said, if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous, and he's the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for the sins of the whole world.
Gathering in the parish hall for food and fellowship and
joining us via Facebook, via live stream. We're glad you're here with us, but we miss seeing your face. If you're here in DFW, we would love to have you come and be with us in person. We want to see your face again. We want to cordially invite you and encourage you to come back and be with us. We miss you. We've saved a place for you. So please come back and be with us in person. We want to see you again. Hopefully by now you've all received the letter that Bishop and I sent out. We're very excited to tell you that our Bishop's Committee unanimously agreed to accept Bishop Reed's generous invitation to move to the new property up at 4301 Meadowbrook Drive in Fort Worth. And so we're very excited about that. That offers so many wonderful opportunities for us here at St. Timothy's. Opportunities for growth, for outreach, and so we're very excited. And above all that, the facility is newer, it's in good condition, and it will give us an opportunity to continue to be what we've always been, right? God's holy people gathered around his altar to do his work in the world and to worship him according to the Anglican way and the Anglo-Catholic tradition. So we're very excited about that. So that leads me to what's going to be happening next week. Next week's going to be a very special Sunday because we're going to be celebrating the Feast of St. Mary the Virgin. And we're also going to be instituting a new Dominican order. It'll be the first one in the Anglican Church in North America. We're very excited about that. And Bishop, if you would you tell us a little bit more about that?
Will. You probably figured out that if it says Dominican order, there must be somebody named Dominic involved. And that would be very sharp. Just like when if I said to you Franciscan order, I wouldn't be able to fool any of you as to who that's about. But St. Dominic was a remarkable saint. I hope you'll look him up, because guess what? Today's the Feast of St. Dominic. So, A, that's really important. B, if you look up Dominicans, you'll see after their names, the initials OP. That doesn't look like Dominic, does it? No, it doesn't stand for OP. It means Order of Preachers. That's because the Dominicans were primarily engaged in the world of teaching, preaching, and furthering the faith. And if you really stop and think about it, that's what we need today. In fact, if it were today, St. Dominic would be called a chief evangelist and church planter. That's what many would call him. And do you like when we do benediction, which is my second favorite liturgy? You remember the two hymns we sing? Therefore we before him bending, O saving victim opening wide. Who do you think wrote that? A Dominican by the name of St. Thomas Aquinas. So what we're forming, and it has the blessing of obviously Bishop Reed and his assisting bishop, by the way, and also it has the we have a special committee in the church, an Anglican Church in North America, for religious orders. This will be the fourth established religious order in the ACNA, but the first Dominican. And we're excited about the possibility. I think you probably know that there's already going to be somebody who will begin his postulancy very soon. And I won't tell you his name, but his initials are Brian Pickard. And this is an order that we know is going to grow. It also means that I will have the blessing as the superior for the time being of being intimately involved in the work of this religious order and the formation. And you'll hear more about that in the very near future. But thanks for the opportunity. And I might want to add a little something else, if I may, Father. And that is, where would a Dominican friar live? In a friary, right? Just like a Franciscan would live in a friary. But we don't have a friary here, because the city of Fort Worth just taxes our buildings all the time. We can't go in them. But guess what? There's a residence built into the complex over at the new St. Timothy's. And guess what? That's going to be the friary. Are you excited?
Yes.
And that means on site, we will have a religious order praying at the shrine for you daily. You will have a religious order in place where you can ask for prayers, because they will pray before the Blessed Sacrament, because Dominicans have always had a great love for the Blessed Sacrament. Anyway, thank you, Father.
Thank you, Bishop. So next week, we gather, there's going to be so much to celebrate. So what we're going to be doing is we'll celebrate Mass here, then we'll gather for food and fellowship, then we're going to go over to the property over at 4301 Meadowbrook Drive, and we're going to bless and consecrate the building which will become the friary, the Dominican Order in the ACNA. And also you get an opportunity to tour the facility over there. See it for yourself and see what God is doing, the great things that God is doing.
Father, I need to ask you one thing.
Please.
The interesting thing about this friary dedication this coming week is that when St. Dominic died on somewhere on the 5th or 6th of August 1221, he had trained a new cohort of Dominicans who were from England, and they just had come ashore that very day that he died. And within a few days, on August 15th, 1221, exactly 800 years ago the next week, they established their first foundation in England. So being that we're in the English tradition, something happening for the exactly 800 years ago happening in our midst is quite something. So I thank you that I get to spend the beginning of that with you.
And you know, none of this is an accident, my friends. God works all this stuff out, right? Because he's the Lord of history, right? And so he's writing history amongst us even now. So it's very exciting, friends. We're living in exciting times. It's wonderful being part of what God is doing. So please join us next week, because wonderful things are going to be happening here at St. Timothy's, and we want you to be a part of it. So I would now like to invite anyone who is celebrating a birthday or anniversary to come forward, please. We would like to invite Joanne, if you would please come forward.
I need all the prayer warriors, in particular, I think those who daughters of the cross or prayer warriors. As you know, in 1994, Joe is diagnosed with breast cancer. So we've been very, very blessed over these years. But a few things that are a little bit troublesome have appeared. And tomorrow, Joe will have two appointments. And Tuesday, she'll meet with the oncologist. So we will keep you posted, but we are in real need of your prayers for her healing at this time. Realize God's inward anointing, the Holy Spirit fall mightily upon Joanne, we pray. If anything is amiss at this time, we are praying that you are going to heal it right on the spot. We believe in you, Lord Jesus, and we trust in you. And we know that you are doing far greater things than we can hope or imagine. And therefore, join with the prayers of many, we offer up to you our prayer that you will heal her completely and totally. We will then have an opportunity to rejoice in the healing that you are doing so great in Jesus Christ. Amen. Every now and then somebody says to me, why are you do a few things at Mass that are different from the way we did it? That's kind of what some of the apostles said to Jesus when there were sick people. And they would say, why are you doing something different? And he would have replied as he did so many times, because that's what we do. So if you would look in the Bible, I want you to jot down the number of times that the word healing is used as it relates to Jesus' public ministry. All we do is what Jesus does.
Also this morning, we're going to be consecrating some new items, some candlesticks and a holy water container. And so that's going to be taking place today.
You may stand.
These are gifts from the Ackerman family.
Well, the candlesticks are in honor of Bishop Ackerman's 75th birthday and in thanksgiving for the ministry of the Ackermans here with us for such a long time. And the rest of the items were purchased by the church, but at a super duper 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 price, and we couldn't resist. So we needed them, so we got a few of those.
Our help is in the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
From this time forth, forevermore.
Blessing, praise, and thanksgiving be unto thee, O Father, Son, and Holy Ghost, for thou put it upon the hearts of thy faithful people to give thee thanks and praise, and in particular at this time, to set apart for worship and to bless and consecrate these candlesticks, that they may burn brightly and be a light to lighten the Gentiles and to be the glory of thy people Israel. And Lord, we give thanks that we have a shrine of Our Lady of the Annunciation, patroness, queen and patroness of Texas, where these will shine brightly to the honor and glory of thy holy name through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Almighty and everlasting God, thou didst once again put in the hearts of people to give thee thanks and praise. We pray in this day of evil, this day of concern, that we continue to have holy water available to give thee honor and praise. And we pray that thou wouldst bless and sanctify this holy water vat, that many may have holy water in their homes, whereby they can speak against the enemy and cleanse through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God is ordained.
abstain the sacrifices of the law and its command that among the rest wherein the wheaten cake should be borne on plates of silver to thine altar that thou wouldst sanctify these chalices. Bless these chalices prepared for the use of thy ministry by the loving devotion of thy servants who pour upon it that sanctification of thine which thou didst pour upon the sacred chalice of Melchizedek, thy servant, and although neither in precious metal nor by human skill can do anything made worthy of thine altars, yet do thou grant that these chalices may be made holy by thy benediction through Christ our Lord. Amen.
O Lord, be pleased to consecrate and hallow these chalices by this anointing and by our benediction as a successor to the apostles in Christ Jesus our Lord, who in the unity of the Holy Spirit lives and reigneth one God, world without end.
Thank you.
charity, I would ask for you to pray for two former members of St. Timothy's who have been called home by the Lord, one being Robert Purcell, and the other one being Robert Floyd, formerly of this parish. The former having been, both of them having been active at one time. But if you recognize the name Floyd, you may recall that his daughter is the one who has Antonio that we use and we are blessed with on Palm Sunday. Pray, brethren, this my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God the Father Almighty.
May the Lord receive this sacrifice at thy hands for the praise and glory of his name, both for our benefit and that of all his holy church.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit,
lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
Do this in remembrance of me.
times after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of this, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Do this as oft as ye shall drink it in remembrance of me." Therefore, Lord Heavenly Father, according to the institution of thy dearly beloved Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, we thy old servants would celebrate and make here before thy divine majesty with these thy holy gifts, which we now offer unto thee, the memorial thy Son hath commanded us to make, having remembrance his blessed passion and precious death, his mighty resurrection and glorious ascension, rendering unto thee most ardent thanks for the innumerable benefits procured to us by the saints. And we most humbly beseech thee, O merciful Father, to hear us, that thy almighty goodness vouchsafe to bless and sanctify with thy word and Holy Spirit these thy gifts and creatures of bread and wine, that we, receiving them according to thy Son, our Savior Jesus Christ, holy institution, in remembrance of his death and passion, may be partakers of his most blessed body and blood. And we earnestly desire thy bodily goodness, mercifully to accept this our sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving, most humbly beseeching thee to grant by the merits and death of thy Son Jesus Christ, and through faith in his blood, we and all thy whole church may obtain remission of our sins and all the benefits of his passion. And here we offer and present unto thee, O Lord, ourselves, our souls and bodies, to be a reasonable, holy, and living sacrifice unto thee, humbly beseeching thee, that we and all others who shall be partakers of this holy communion may worthily receive the most precious body and blood of thy Son, Jesus Christ, be filled with thy grace and heavenly benediction, made one body with him, that he may dwell in us and we in him. Remember also, Lord, thy servants and handmaidens who have gone before us with the sign of faith, our rest in the sleep of peace. To these, O Lord, all rest in Christ, we beseech thee, grant a place, refreshment of life and peace. And although we are unworthy through our manifold sins to offer unto thee any sacrifice, yet we beseech thee to accept this our bounden duty and service, and to command these our prayers and supplications through the ministry of thy holy angels to be brought up into thy holy tabernacle before the sight of thy divine majesty, not weighing our merits, but pardoning our offenses through Jesus Christ our Lord, by whom, and with whom, and in whom, in the unity of the Holy Ghost, all honor and glory be unto thee, O Father Almighty, world without end.
Amen.
Give us this day our daily bread.
gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of thy dear Son, Jesus Christ, and to drink his blood, that our sinful bodies may be made clean by his body, and our souls washed through his most precious blood, and that we may evermore dwell in him, and he in us. Amen.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him that taketh away the sin of the world. Lord, I am not worthy that thou shouldst come under my roof.
But speak the word only, and my soul shall be healed.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God,
we most heartily thank thee, for thou hast thus safe to feed us, who have duly received these holy mysteries, of the spiritual food and the most precious body and blood, of thy Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and thus assure us thereby thy favor and goodness towards us, and that we are very members incorporated in the mystical body of thy Son, which is the blessed company of all faithful people, and are also heirs through hope of thy everlasting kingdom, by the merits of his most precious death and passion. And we humbly beseech thee, O Heavenly Father, so to assist us with thy grace, that we may continue that holy fellowship, and do all such good works as thou hast prepared for us to walk in, through Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with thee and the Holy Ghost be all honor and glory, world without end. Amen.
O God, who didst vouchsafe to enlighten thy church by the merits and teaching of blessed Dominic, thy confessor, grant that us receiving the most holy sacrament of the altar may at all times at the intercession of the saints never be destitute of temporal help, and may always advance in spiritual growth through Jesus Christ, thy Son, our Lord, who liveth and reigneth with thee in the unity of the Holy Ghost, ever one God, world without end. Your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son Jesus Christ our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost be amongst you and remain with you always.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
The beginning of the Holy Gospel according to St. John.
Glory be to thee, O Lord.
In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. The same as in the beginning with God, all things were made by him. Without him was not anything made that was made. It was life, and the light was the light of men, and the light shined in the darkness, and the darkness comprehended it not. There was a man sent from God, his name was John. The same came for a witness, to bear witness of the light, that all men through him might believe. He was not that light, but was sent to bear witness of that light. That was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. He was in the world was made by him, and the world knew him not. Came into his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe in his name, which were born not of blood, nor the will of the flesh, nor the will of man, but of God. And the Word was made flesh
and dwelt among us.
We know his glory, the glorious of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth.
Thanks be to God.
The angel of the Lord announced unto Mary,
and she conceived by the Holy Ghost.
Hail Mary, full of grace, the Lord is with thee. Blessed art thou among women, and blessed is the fruit of thy womb, Jesus.
Holy Mary, Mother of God, pray for us sinners now, and in the hour
through the same Christ our Lord.
Amen. The Mass is ended. Depart in peace.
Saturday.